indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. That was a speed record.
Okay, let's keep going.
I was trying to set the pace.
Now, we could put the presentation up for the, I think, for the public on the website, and Matt can maybe summarize it.
Well, we can, I think we can move through it at
A break? Okay.
Risk.
Tara was gonna open it up and just kind of.
Okay, great.
Okay, I'm Tara Willerup. I'm chairman of the Board of Education. And tonight we're presenting our budget. We've worked really, really hard. We feel it's a very responsible budget. We will, it's to be a successful school district, you know, you need to not only maintain high standards, but actively be aware of how to improve. And here we go. So we always have a vision for conscious improvement. The budget that we are presenting to you has supports the high academic achievement. It promotes social and emotional well-being for all aspects of our community, of our educational community. Enhancements are ready access to technology, which we've been talking about for a long time and continuously need to improve and keep moving forward. Additional resources to address programming and achievement gap in special education. We also are focusing on math supports, coaching. We have had a lot of state-mandated changes in our math program, and we need to support our students and our teachers, and the coaching has seemed to be a very efficient and effective method of that. We understand that the budget is very important, and it's a balance between excellence in programming and fiscal responsibility, and we also understand that each student, it's our responsibility to make sure that each student gets a successful path to their future, because a path to their future is a path to all of our futures. Yep. So that's what we thought through when we were putting up our presentation. Matt will go through the PowerPoint more succinctly, but thank you for having us here tonight.
I mean, I could if we want to go there. We have a slide at the end, knowing that, you know, the detail is up on the website and you've had a chance to look through it, that is kind of the ins and outs of the dollars. And maybe we could leave that up and that would be a summary and we could kind of ask the questions off of there. But overall, we're asking for a 2.2% increase. You can see it's about $1.4 million above spending from last year. So let me.
As you zip through, I do just want you to get credit for maybe the fifth or sixth slide. That's the recent budget increases. That's a graph I just want you to pause on. For,
all right.
You know, you've done a good job there.
Appreciate it. So this is a historical view, and I think you know, we call it a little bit of the new normal when the financial fallout hit us and we really had to make some adjustments and take closer looks at things. Also, the other key factor that there's detail in the budget, I'm sure we'll get at it a little bit conversationally tonight, is our decline in enrollment. We've seen a significant decline in enrollment over the course of the last 10 years. That's allowed us as a kind of a budget driver, provided us with flexibility not only to reduce, we call those responsible reductions of FTE over time. We've reduced close to 45 positions since 2008, 2009, but also make program enhancements. So we've done quite a few things to our district in that same time frame that have allowed us to move forward and be the school district that we are.
Mm-hmm.
So let me get to right to the dollars and cents. All right, so prior to questions, just to kind of set the stage for where we are, we have framed our budget this year around major drivers. So obviously the biggest driver we deal with, 80% of our costs are associated with personnel, about 60% with contractual obligations, and close to 20% with pension and benefit requirements. So if you take a look at this slide where it talks about additions, the first several line items, the first three, are basically a rollover of the organization. So if you took the same size of our organization, rolled it forward with our contractual obligations, you can see that the teacher's contract, our largest driver, 390 or so staff members, is an increase of about $989,000 or 1.49 to the bottom line. Administrative contract, about $54,000. And SFEP and the nurses, which are our clerical and our nurses bargaining group, which is a sizable unit, about $137,000. we are going into negotiations now. We just kicked that off today, I believe, today or tomorrow, okay, with our custodial bargaining group and our unaffiliated group. We have a placeholder in for reserves. We also have some significant needs that I'm sure will come up in our conversation and questions tonight around staffing, additional 5.1 positions. Two of those are special ed positions at Simsbury High School, where I'm speaking to the decline in overall enrollment across the district. We see contrary in line, I guess, with special ed enrollment. We're going to be up 29 special ed students at Simsbury High School next year. We have a bubble of high-need students that are moving on from Henry James and transitioning to Simsbury High School next year in two particular programs. One is kind of our autism program. The other is our intellectual disabilities program. And in order to kind of have appropriate caseloads, meet those students' needs, we're going to add a teacher in each of those programs.
You used the word bubble. Does that mean that it's the mouse traveling through the snake, or is it a permanent trend?
Well, when we add these two positions to meet those kids' needs?
No, I mean the number of kids. I mean, it's...
What happens in the class after these?
Yes.
Classes after these?
Is a special ed need permanently higher, or are you seeing that it's going to slack back off again?
I don't see that we'll be able to reduce these positions the following year, if that's the question.
That's not really the question. The question is, you use the word bubble. I'm with Linda on this. Just, I'm not attacking you, Matt, just saying.
Yeah. So maybe it's the wrong word. I mean, we're seeing an increase in enrollment in special ed overall.
Right.
I mean, if you look at the last 3 years, we're down 150 in overall enrollment at Simsbury High School, and we're up 30 or so in special ed.
So there's no reason to believe that is going to decline again.
We've been at about a 12 to 12.7%. We call it an incident rate, which is the percentage of students with identified needs in the district. It's been between that for the last 3 or 4 years. You know, we've made some enhancements in in-house programming that I think will help to mitigate costs, but I don't think it's going to lower the number of kids that we have.
Okay.
If that gets added a little more specifically. Okay. We have a slight increase in textbooks. Professional development is really two areas. There's a responsive classroom initiative across the elementary school principals that they really talked about a desired programming approach, and there's a one-time cost of about $25,000 to train the staffs at all the various buildings through an organization that's an expert in this responsive classroom. And the NEASC accreditation at the high school comes once every 10 years. So there's a one-time cost there of, I believe it's $25,000 we have in the budget. We have to house people, we have to feed them meals, and it's a one-time shot that needs to be addressed and is done. I believe we did that 10 years ago as mm-hmm. well, and that accreditation process takes place next year.
And that's once every 10 years, that cost?
Yeah.
And you have that in your operations budget for next year?
For next year. That's part of the increase in professional development.
Yeah. Okay.
Of that $50,000 increase, 25 is the responsive classroom and 25 is the NEASC support. You can see our insurance increase. That will be our second largest driver. It's an increase of $470,000, or 0.71%. That's significant, and I know the board members that were here and involved in the process last year know that when I had come forward and presented a budget that our board approved at 2.47. That's the budget I presented to the Board of Finance, and we started conversations about the Internal Service Fund and the levels of reserves, and we were able to collaboratively work together, and that's the reason we got to a 1.3% increase. In our communication back to the public and to our board, we felt we got the services of a 2.47 programmatically at the cost of a 1.3 because we were able to do some things relative to that Internal Service Fund. We use that fund, obviously, during the rate setting process, and we were able to really utilize those funding to smooth the rates. And in reality, the last 2 or 3 years, we either had a flat line item here or we had a decreased line item. So while this isn't an exorbitant increase, we do not have the level of flexibility with the Internal Service Fund this year that we've had in the past because of some of the long-term commitments we're making to pay down OPEB and pension, which, you know, we'll see benefits on in years to come. When you roll up all of those, it's a 3.66% increase. And then we talk about operational efficiencies or what we can do to mitigate that cost. We have six certified staff retirements that are already committed. So we look at a differential between the high point salary going out and potentially a hire of somewhere mid in the range. It's a ballpark, and that's usually how it's flushed out. So we can gain some realized savings there. about 150,000. We are projected to go down 106 students next year, K-12. As a result of that, we took a hard look at our roll forward of class size sections. We're able to reduce four sections, K-6, keep our classes within the class size guidelines, which is definitely a value of our board and of our parents. Decrease two sections at the secondary level, one at Henry James, one at Simsbury High School. So a reduction of six full-time staffing positions overall to really offset some of those staffing requests that we do have. So net, we go down almost a position, but we're really able to meet some pretty significant needs that we have in the district. We see some savings in fuel pricing, about $150,000 of favorability, which helps us move down about 0.23. Equipment requests are down $100,000 from last year, able to find some savings there. And Burke just got done with a copier contract, which is a regional copier bid, and we're able to find savings of about $92,000. So overall, close to $1 million, are 1.45%, and that's how we net out at the 2.2. That's about as quick as I can do it.
Right. Thank you. Thank you very much. And I do just want to note that although we did have on the agenda that we would do the minutes, given the fact that we're very pressed for time because of another meeting coming in after us, that I think we'll push that off until next week when we have our regular meeting. And I'd also note that I think the same presentation that you just sort of skipped through quickly was what you did to the Board of Ed.
Yes.
So for people who want to see you do the whole...
It's available on SCTV. It's available on our, you know, website.
Right.
So I will leave this up here. This return on investment is something we like to talk about, and it's kind of the accolades section of how we're doing as a school district.
Yep.
And I think collectively, as we've worked to sustain and promote excellence, we have some things to really be proud of. So. Thank you.
Great. Thank you.
Do you want a motion to table the minutes?
Good idea.
Thank you, Laura.
Can I have a motion to table the minutes until next week, please?
So move.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I guess I didn't get to make a unilateral decision. All those important things. I guess what I'd like to do is open it up for questions first on the presentation, but then we can kind of go section by section.
I had instructions from our friends at SCTV to move this.
Oh.
You make sure.
Didn't.
All right.
And did you move Barbara over with you? Yeah, thank you.
Barbara has a mic. Yeah. Barbara?
Can Barbara, can you hear us?
She's on mute.
She's on mute.
Oh. I don't think so.
Yeah, I just want to make sure Barbara's connected. Barbara Pettigene is participating by phone. Barb? She's not hearing us. Where is...
She was connected.
I'm sorry, I put my phone on mute and I was talking to you all that time.
Oh. She was what?
Okay. So I just wanted to make sure you were there and able to participate. So let me open it up.
So, Linda, you might not have gotten it on the record if there's a vote. So the motion to waive the minutes, I voted in favor.
Okay, thank you. All right, so why don't we start with going through questions from people on our board. Maybe we could start with you, Barb. Any questions on the presentation that Matt so succinctly went through just now? Since we've all had time to look at it.
Yeah, I have a couple sort of, well, I don't know if they're easy or not. The first one's easy. Have we gotten the actuarial numbers on pension and OPEB? I noticed in the report it was an estimate.
Just pension,
not... Have we actually gotten the report?
Not OPEB yet, Barb. So that's one area that if, you know, when we look towards flexibility, that potentially could be some level, but we haven't finalized those numbers yet. Next couple weeks.
So what's holding up the finalization? Because I got all the other reports for town except yours.
Sean had been in touch. He just walked in the room.
It's
Sean
his
has been
fault.
In touch with the actuary, and their goal is to get them by the end of the month. And as had been discussed, we had some data that was later from the Board of Ed side in
right.
getting them some of the census.
But did we tell them that's not good enough? The end of the month, this month.
That's what the target was. Via the email that I saw. I did not personally speak with the actuary.
Can we follow up with them? Because they really owe us that sooner, because that could be a possible help here.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
Yeah. So, Sean, you'll check in with
I'll
them?
I'll email her back. It was just yesterday, right?
Okay,
the next one, I know that Brooke and I spent some time talking about the whole utilities. He and I had a conference call on it. Mm-hmm. The observation that I still want to make is we're projecting favorable of 200 this year to budget, and we're planning next year to only take 150 of that 200. And I still think there could be... You know, there's questions on pricing changes, and, you know, there's lots of moving pieces and utilization, and clearly usage at one of the schools is way higher, and that's a little bit confusing. And I know so there were some things that we were going to follow up on, but generally speaking, I just kind of want to put on that table that extra 50. Is there a potential there that we take a closer look at that fuel utilization?
I had a quick question on that. Because I guess when I was looking at the $150,000 in savings, I was assuming that was associated with the fixed cost, the fixed fuel pricing, the $150,000. So I take it $547,200 was what we had anticipated spending this year based on a normal winter. We spent only $161,000 because it has not been a normal winter, but then... Like Barb, I couldn't understand why the projected year-end expenditures are $372,000 when we're in March. And
it's 70 degrees out today.
Yeah. It'll be 75 tomorrow. And then, and like Barb, I guess I was also thinking on the $397,200, that would be $150 based on the fixed fuel price.
30, thank you.
Is the amount not lower, though? Because, again, that's based on an estimated number of gallons of oil that will... we expect in a normal winter times the fixed fuel price, or is it based on just taking the 150 off the prior projection?
Well, we have a current appropriation of $547,200 for the oil and natural gas for heating. So we are decreasing by $150,000 the budget for next year in large part based on some of the fixed fuel pricing and somewhat just based on estimated usage. Part of your question, as I understand it, was why is our projection for the end of the year $372,000? We will never do a perfect job of estimating energy, but in terms of that estimate, I still believe it's a reasonable estimate. Based on our experience, and I don't think based on a mild winter that budgeting about 20,000, 25,000 more would seem unrealistic when we've had such a mild winter.
I understand that. This is through 7 months. I'm just figuring for February, March, April, May, June, do we expect to spend more than double what we've spent already?
As we updated in the quarterly report, you'll see some of those same detailed numbers in our next quarter, and we can certainly review and see how that's going.
I want to share that I think you might be being a little conservative. And remember, last year we had a lot of conversation about utility, and we mm-hmm. told you that your numbers were hard. And if you take a look at it, we're having significantly favorable. And weather's a piece of it, but I think we didn't necessarily build in all that savings you guys got from all the good projects that you did for this year's budget. And we'll see next year, we'll be having this conversation, and we'll see where we come out on mm-hmm. utilities. But I think you might have it still a little on the hard side.
Mm-hmm. And we'll certainly want to true up, like we spoke about, Barbara, try to look at where the estimated savings achieved in the electricity, which is the primary area. And when you and I had spoken previously, I did begin the follow-up with the consulting engineer that we use for our some of our projects, and be happy to share with you further some of the support on that.
Okay, we can take it offline.
Okay.
And then, Linda, did you want me to ask other questions or just only the big picture questions
I think let's start, give everybody a chance to do the big picture questions, and then we can walk through these yellow pages in more detail.
Okay.
Does that sound okay for everyone?
Okay, I think those are probably my only really, well, on CIP, and I assume we'll do that separately, I have a couple questions, kind of big picture, but we haven't even talked about that yet, but we need to make sure we put some time aside and get to CIP.
Yep, okay. Why don't we just start on, is it Rob, do you have questions on the PowerPoint?
Well, yeah, I have thousands of questions, but the process being the first one, so I'm going to sort of sit back, and I have some specific questions, but I'd rather wait to get into the meat of it first.
Okay.
All right.
I have little picture questions.
You can have little picture questions. You mean on the yellow pages?
Yeah, yeah, okay. Yeah.
Any PowerPoint questions from you gentlemen?
I think I had just, I thought it was just one. I'm trying to remember where it is.
I can ask one while you're
absolutely
looking.
Go for it. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
you mentioned the NEASC $25,000. I'm looking for pennies everywhere. I'll admit that. If that is in fact just a once every 10-year question, and we've got surplus from this year, can we put that on the list of things to pay for now with extra money now and take it out of your next year budget? Yeah, I mean that.
Encumber it, right?
That makes sense to you, Barbara, and to you, Sean?
Linda, let's just make a note of it. I think we're going to use up that million we've got pretty quick, but let's put that on, as a potential on it.
Right. Yep. Okay. I'm looking for everything.
If we encumber it now, wouldn't it come out of the Board of Ed's current year budget, or we're saying you want to take it out of reserves?
To get technical, I guess I'd say you're right, Jeff. We wouldn't be able to encumber it for next year, but as long as you have given us the guidance that you would pay for that next year, then I think it achieves the same thing.
Yeah. Okay. Correct. So I might have the terminology wrong.
Okay.
You got
yeah.
my drift.
Yeah.
So you can't encumber anything in your
no.
budget for next year?
No, it would be a commitment on our part that we would pick up that cost.
Right.
In that same vein, my question was...
Jeff, or, you know, when we get to the end of the year, we take, I'm sure this will weave its way into the conversation, non-lapsing, is there favorable experience there? That would be... a vehicle that we talked about last year, if there was, we could accomplish the same thing utilizing that.
Right, right.
That would be one way to do it current year.
The of course, the money at the end of the year, probably much of it will go into the spend to save account, though I would think no. I mean, last year, I don't think we returned any money to the reserves. We returned the money to the spend to save account.
Right.
So I'm not sure it'll be available to us.
Spend to save, meaning the non-lapsing?
Non-lapsing.
Okay.
Non-lapsing.
Yeah. But my other question on related to the NEASC was we talked about the $50,000 increase, but I thought it was the increase requested is about $100,000 in that line item for professional development. And I had a chance to ask Burke some questions earlier, and he had mentioned that, and Burke, correct me if I'm mischaracterizing this, but had mentioned that we have some obligations, I think, through our contracts to provide a certain level of in-service training, and while the money hasn't been used in the past, we need to have the money in the budget to ensure that we have it. And I guess my thought on that was that we might consider using our historical spending, since I don't think the contract provisions change, and this is something new, but to use our historical spending, and then again, if you need to come back, because there's a contractual obligation to provide an amount up to an additional $100,000, that we might do that at that time. But rather than take the $100,000 roughly increase now, we could commit to the $25,000 for the NEASC, and then on the other $50,000, come back to us if in fact you're finding it's trending upwards. But again, we're looking for pennies here, trying to come closer to bring this within budget.
Sure. Just to update folks quickly on the line item, on pages 22 and 23 from the yellow sheets, so we have a line item that's called professional development in the middle there.
Yep.
And so the current year budget is $171,950, and then we have the $50,000 increase for the responsive classroom and the NEASC, resulting in a request of $221,950 for next year. But Jeff's referring to the actual expenditures are
projected
quite a bit lower in terms of 14-15. Last year, current year, we project about $124,677. And as Jeff stated, we have both in our teachers' contract as well as our administrators' contract, we have certain, a portion of this professional development line item is based on this contractual reimbursement for advanced study. So $52,000 out of that is the teachers' contract that we budget for, and $15,000 is the CESA contract. And if everybody were to, who was eligible, they have to be folks who are sixth-year or seventh-year staff in our salary schedule. There's about 166 of those people. If everybody got that reimbursement, it would be about $145,000. So we're obviously not assuming that most people are going to do it. Spending has trended somewhat downward in the last 4 or 5 years on that. We've lowered the budget from $60,000 down to about $52,000 in the last several years. But to Jeff's point, we can certainly talk about making that assumption lower if there's a an understanding that there's some sort of
it's a contractual obligation, so it's an easy sell for you guys if you come before us, because we're contractually obligated.
Any other questions on the PowerPoint section?
I'll go ahead and ask. Matt, just at the bottom on the reductions, I'm on the money slide.
Can we go back to it? The major driver's summary?
Yeah, the major driver's summary. The six known certified staff retirements, that's $150,000, because that's the difference between their High Point salary and their pension salary? No?
No. So the difference between, we're not responsible for teacher pensions, that's states.
Okay.
So High Point salary going out, and then the assumption that you hire somebody at mid-level contract. So it's taking the difference. 20-some-odd thousand.
We use a round estimate of $25,000 for that.
Okay, so just for my benefit, walk me through the certified requests of five new employees, six retirements, and the closing down of six sections.
Okay.
Just the pluses and minuses, so that I get this.
Yep. Can I go back here? That's the slide you're referring to, right?
That's not. That's the old one. That's an old. That's.
Oh, hold on. Okay.
That's just.
That's
personnel.
Just personnel. Yeah. Okay.
There you go. Okay. So there's five new people being hired. $400,000.
Correct.
$80,000 apiece. All right. And so, but we're gonna. The budget is benefited from six people that are retiring, but being replaced by six people.
Correct.
Are those the same six that are up above?
No.
All right. And then we have.
Then you have six sections or teaching positions in other places in the district. So across your five elementary schools, when we roll up the numbers, there's four places where you can reduce a teaching position from a team. So for example, you go from five teachers to four, but the number of students still keeps you in your guidelines.
So somewhere else in this book, there is a reconciliation of net new full-time equivalents, which is about one, and that's the five new less these six sections?
You're down 0.9 FTE.
Okay, not the six retirees. The six retirees are replaced by full-time equivalents also.
Just at a cheaper price.
At a cheaper price. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Let's go ahead and go through some of these yellow pages. I have lots of questions, but Barbara, do you want to start with questions on the line items?
Can I ask another Barbara, before you start?
Where I think that maybe is at least a potential opportunity that I wanted to ask about.
Barb.
38.
She can't hear what she's saying. Barb, can I just ask a question before you get started? We went quickly through the slide, but I'm a newbie rookie here and haven't paid enough attention as a 25-year resident of Simsbury to this process to know. Just tell me what the Board of Ed has done in terms of, you know, who's looked at it, who's approved these things, how far along. This has been approved by the Board of Ed.
This is the Board after, of Education.
So it's a ground up budget from the department.
the department, from the school.
Right.
To our central office, meeting with the principals for a budget, thorough budget presentation of each building.
Okay.
We go up through a process there of putting together priorities. We present, the way we've done it with the board is we present it along the lines of main drivers, so we kind of build it. So a special education presentation, a staffing presentation. We did a workshop where we covered main drivers like technology, insurance, pension, textbooks. We go through, respond to questions there. The last presentation is kind of a wrap of the superintendent's budget. When that gets approved, comes the Board of Ed budget, and the next step is bringing it here for discussion with the Board of Finance.
All right. Thank you. All right, Barb.
My question was on page 38. In looking through this, it didn't look like you had any reductions. And can I clarify that? Because the six positions that you don't need, are those terminations?
Terminations?
No.
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 Retirements.
What do you mean?
So the reductions, so where you're adding six and you're eliminating six because of class size?
Yeah.
You mean are you actually needing to lay anybody off?
Retirements.
No, she's talking about the reductions.
No, that was my question.
So,
no,
we,
right.
Very limited.
Very limited due to retirements, but there'll be six less classroom teaching positions in the district.
And how many are not retirements of the six?
One at the elementary level and a portion of portion of one position at the secondary level.
Okay, so now.
Okay, so then my question on page 38. Mm-hmm. We don't seem to spend the unemployment, and you can only get the you only owe the unemployment when you lay somebody off. So since we haven't been using that, is there an extra 50 in that account we could maybe use? Maybe 40, 50, I don't know what the right number is. I'm sure you can calculate what that one in, however you measured it, is worth.
We can certainly look at that. We've had some really favorable experience over the last several years. It used to be significantly higher, but that's certainly an area that we can estimate closer.
Well, the state limits how long you can get unemployment, so you can just calculate what their max payout could be on the state, and you'll know it for what's planned. And I'm not saying take it all the way down to zero, because there could be another. But normally, if you let somebody go for cause mid-year, you don't pay unemployment, I presume. So, unless it's a planned, layoff due to something we're planning right now, I'm guessing you don't have many layoffs during the year.
Correct.
So, we should be able to plan that number a little closer is all I'm suggesting.
Mm-hmm.
Than the 60.
Once
Does everyone
we know-
see where I am on the insurance unemployment comp?
Yep.
So if we look, so to Barb's point, if I guess we look at 14.
Page 38, account 08022010, and we spent $5,000 in 2015. We're looking at spending $16,000 this year, and we're budgeting 60 again.
Right.
It just looked like that was one spot where we might have an opportunity to trim.
40.
And I just want to give Rob a chance here because
I thought I had this, but I'm confused.
Understandably,
because I thought that all the retirees were being replaced by full time equivalents at lower salary, and we were hiring five new people.
But we're also eliminating positions because of class size to offset that.
Right. That was
the eliminations of positions in class size are not just retirees.
But they're
also
no, it's a total. It's
a little more that are existing people that are.
We double counting. That's I guess that's what I'm trying to figure out. Is $150,000 real, or is it? That's $25,000 a position from a retiree being replaced by somebody that's less expensive. And is that are those salaries of the less expensive employees included in the 402 of the 5.1 that are being hired up above?
That would presume that the new requests are for the retirees leaving, and there really isn't a connection that I'm aware of there, because those are new positions.
They're new special ed positions. couple of them.
So can I just ask you to clarify where it says decrease of four sections? How many FTEs are, so a section is equivalent to an FTE?
Correct.
Mm-hmm. And decrease of two FTEs is two more. So that's six people that you're eliminating, not talking at all about the retirees.
So for a total of 12.
Well, but the retirees will be replaced by...
Well, no, I know, but if you just look at reductions before you start adding.
Where'd you get the other six?
I guess I would...
Certified 10.
If we've identified the six people that...
Is it the sections in the FTE that have people confused that I wasn't consistent?
No, it's $150,000.
Right, so there's six positions.
So you're worried the $150 in savings is a double dip?
Yeah. Why isn't that included in the six sections being removed? Why aren't those salary differentials, since you've identified what you're going to pay the five people you're going to hire, and you can identify the six people that are going to retire or from those sections, why is there an additional $150,000 because people are retiring? There aren't those the same six people that are... Not necessarily.
So is it 12? No. So is it 12?
No. So I may, just to do a one-to-one. I don't know if this will help or not, but I eliminate a fourth grade teaching position at Squadron Line School.
Yeah.
I have a high school teacher that's retiring that's a math teacher that I need to rehire. I'm going to save $23,000 on that hire, separate of anything that's going on with this fourth grade teaching position.
But to Barbara's earlier question, fourth grade teacher that's leaving, are you laying, is that you're just assuming someone will be moving out? There's attrition, or?
Are we laying them off?
Or do we need the contingency of unemployment?
So they're retirees and attrition.
Yeah. Some. Yeah.
And that does not require us to pay.
Well, we don't know.
Well, one plus.
We're down in the weeds a little bit here, but Barbara's going for the $60,000, and, you know, I'm
a little bit, Rob,
rooting
a little
for
bit.
Her. But I want to be sure that we... So the 150 is a guess, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Very much so, and that's what I was trying to say.
So
we've used that.
So is the salary, Rob, higher than the 5.1?
Okay.
But you have a salary schedule. You go out. You
spec those jobs, though. I mean, I would say that. No.
We what those jobs?
You spec those jobs out. You know what the
market is.
What the range salary range should be for.
We have a teacher's contract for all of them, so you post, you interview.
Okay. You know what you're going to hire them at.
You know, and you want to hire the best, and that best may cost you a little bit more.
All right, so let's come back to Barb's question, which is, of the people, the six people that are going to be either leave by attrition or have to be let go because those positions are no longer available, those are not jobs we're keeping, how many of those are we going to have to pay unemployment insurance to? That's the question.
If everything stayed equal where we are on March 7th,
right.
One full position at the elementary school, a teacher who has been at the next Board of Ed meeting will be reduced in force, and a partial position at the secondary level.
So the $60,000 is probably too high for that, given the experience previous years. I don't know what the $16,000 you're looking at in this fiscal year relate, how many positions does that relate to, Bert?
One of the misnomers is it's not all about layoffs, because the way that the system works, and some of you may have this in your business, you can pay for people who've worked for you part-time who've left another job. It's not just related to people that we've let go or something.
I'm just trying to get a roll out.
If you haven't cut their hours.
Yeah, yes. Yes. But anyhow, it's not, it doesn't tend to be very, very large dollars, but we've had enough of these with the state that we've tried to argue, and we won't go to hearings now because we know what the answer is going to be.
Okay, I'm satisfied temporarily. So let's move ahead.
Okay,
Barb, do you have other questions besides 08-2210?
Not on the yellow pages. The other stuff is in the capital area. But I do want to say, can you please have that one as a takeaway? Because I think there's a little room there. What we're trying to do is, when we get to the end of this, we'll let you know how we're seeing the big picture, if we have time to even talk about it as a group. But we still have some concerns about some of the state money that's assumed in here, the way that Joe put together the numbers the first time through, and we may be tight, and so we're trying to point out some places that you guys, we'd like to have you take a second look at it and let us know what you think.
Great. So we have 35 minutes left before the next meeting comes in. Do you, Sean, do you have the modeling tool? Were you planning to put that up kind of to address what Barbara was just talking about?
Yeah, it's ready if you want to see. You're talking about mill rate worksheet?
The mill rate worksheet.
Yeah, it's there. I don't have a presentation ready.
Nope,
it's just
nope,
if you want to play
fine.
With it.
So why don't we keep the last 10 or 15 minutes just to take a look at that?
That's fine.
And then between now and then, we'll just continue on with questions. I know one larger contextual question, kind of for the sake of our new folks. If you could just talk a little bit about the $639,000 at the end of last year that went into the spend to save accounts. Is it, if I have that right?
It's really the non-lapsing account.
Right, well,
I'm
using a layman's term. The non-lapsing account. Can you just talk a little bit about that and what you've done to produce some savings in that manner?
Sure. So built into the current year budget for electricity was the plan that the Board of Finance was part of to do energy improvements at the high school, Tooten Hills, and Henry James. So that was planned and happened this summer with the bulk, approximately $370,000 of the $639,000. There is a small balance of, I believe, $19,000 that is earmarked for a solar project at the high school. The balance of that, or about $250,000, $249,000, was intended to be spent on out-of-district tuition, transportation, and those types of costs. So all of the energy work was expended for those three major school projects that happened this summer. So that savings was assumed as a part of the current year budget.
Okay. Did you both understand all that? Just want to make sure. Okay. So I have
No, I'm saying the newbies, I'm sorry, I'm shaking my head.
Let me open it up to the rest of you. I know I asked Matt some questions, but prior to the meeting. I'll ask them again in public, but give you the chance first. Any other questions on these yellow pages?
I had a few.
Yep, go ahead, Jeff.
Well, first, I did want to point out, because I had a chance to talk with Burke earlier, that when you look at the numbers up here, and you look at some of these pages, some of what's reflected up here, additional costs, are reflected in savings elsewhere. So I wanted to point out that I appreciate that. I think one good example was on contracted pupil services for tuition. The projected end of the year expenditures this year for line item 02-03130 is $835,000, and next year it's projected to be $715,000. And so I believe that is associated with taking some work back that we had given to CREC by bringing somebody in-house. So when I look at the 5.1 FTE, I assume that FTE probably includes the expense associated with that, but then we do have a savings here of $120,000. So I just want to point out that I'm glad to see that, and I appreciate that. We all do. And I, you know, in looking at the budget, the yellow pages on line item 07-04300, which is on page 34, I believe, we had an increase a year prior of $54,000 for this year, and it looks like we're projecting that $54,000 increase from last year is going to stick, and we're going to need that additional money again this year. So we went from $144,560 to $198,000. We spent $108,000 over the first 7 months, and we expect to spend the $198,000 by the end of the year. And I didn't know whether we had cleaned up the sheets now so that there's no overlap, but under the line item on page 21, 02-06420, we talk about a significant cost of maintenance to our smart board technology investment as projector bulb replacement. And so when I look at that line item, I'm thinking, okay, well, projector bulb replacement is probably
considerable. Those things are damn expensive. So there's a cost to having, you know, the smart boards. We get that. But then might then some of that increase on that line item perhaps have a mitigating impact on the 198.020 on page 34, so that we might be able to achieve some savings there. And again, I know it may, and it sounds like a lot of detail, and it may only be 25,000 or 30,000, but given the what we're struggling with, any amount we can shore up is helpful.
I think the difference is one is more of a supply, so we categorize that more of a an expected physical supply change. They are very expensive, and have to be rotated regularly. Whereas the other is more for more physical repairs to things. I think it's just more of the more of the chart of accounts, the categorization of where we budget for it. I don't think there's a duplication concern.
So one is more of a equipment repair rather than maintenance, and then we might just take that name off because it can be confusing.
Okay.
Lynn, can we get a quick snapshot, and I don't know if that's when we do the mill rate worksheet of the revenue picture and where we're trying to get?
Yeah, we'll do that when we get to the worksheet.
Okay.
I think, you know, I think, again, just a matter of, I mean, I had a chance to ask Burke questions earlier, just a matter of ensuring that we've taken savings wherever we possibly can. So if we've got energy savings associated with our new initiative last year that we can take, as Barb mentioned, on the utilities, and, you know, again, the expectation that we've talked about year after year, which is doing more with less. And I'm not saying that you're not doing more with less. I think you're doing a great job. But, you know, our obligation is a little different, which is to only spend what we can afford. And right now, we can't really afford a lot more, so.
Other?
On page 16, just the line item 01-01-1500.
Yep.
Can you just explain that? On the reserve for unnegotiated contracts, since it wasn't there before.
Yeah. So this is the impact from this driver's slide, essentially taking all of the unnegotiated contracts of a collective bargaining nature, and it also includes our transportation contract.
So basically,
we put those out in one place as a set aside. Estimate what those will end up being,
and that's for multiple contracts, right?
Correct.
Is that something we typically reserve for?
Yeah.
Every year?
Okay. On both sides,
year, right?
Town
we
side,
just actually
and
moved
the
location
side
of it, but
is it typically that?
Yes.
That
it's
size
that's
too?
Actually not that big.
Okay.
Well, I've seen it
more.
when you've got six or seven units that are out negotiating, then that's going to be a larger number.
Okay.
But then they put it into a lump sum rather than divide it out by bargaining agreement also.
Good move.
Helps with the collective
bargaining. It helps with the process.
Yeah. You don't want to signal it.
I always hate that it has to be included. Just that fact alone, you know, I feel like.
Okay, let me ask a few questions then, too. On page 42, stipends-advisors, I don't really know what these are. It sounds like they're not regular employees, perhaps.
Or extra jobs they're doing.
But we've only spent $29,000 so far this year, and you're projecting $152,000 for the year. So how do we get that?
They basically, they're advisors to clubs at the high school, at the middle school, and those checks tend to get cut at the end of the year after the service for being in the club has been rendered, and then so most of those checks are written like late May.
Oh, so they don't get paid every month? Okay.
No.
Okay. I so love the person that invented these little sticky things. They're great. Electricity, we did talk a little bit about utilities, and Matt, I had raised this with you earlier. I'm just wondering if there's a little room in there. This is on page 30. And you know, the amount has gone up and down, and thankfully down because of your efforts in the recent years to change the way we consume electricity. But you're only projecting that we'll use $748,000 by the end of this year, but you're asking for an increase. And given that it has decreased in recent years,
We're not asking for an increase. It's level funded.
You're asking for an increase over
the
actual
year's experience,
yeah.
Right?
I look at the actual, not what you budgeted.
Sure, but in the utility area, and especially electricity, this is something that Barbara and I spent most of the time talking with on our call. So I will provide a follow up to that. But essentially, it boils down to electricity does have a sensitivity to the degree days and the favorable weather that we've had. One area, for example, is that the modulars at Simsbury High School are an electricity-based heating and cooling. So that does have an impact that we've not seen much this year. There's other part of the distribution system of our boilers, and speaking with the engineer that I referenced earlier, there is a correlation there. Like to try to put more detail behind it, but it isn't a simple fact that just we don't know what the cooling season is going to be like, and given that starting point and what we're favorable this year, I don't think it's at all too conservative. So we can talk further, but I do understand your question.
Okay. Then I wanted to ask about on page 20. Textbooks, and just looking historically, the number for textbooks has gone up and down and bounced around over recent years. But while many things in the school system are not, I totally get the lesson you've given me many times that just because enrollment goes down doesn't mean the number of principals reduces and those kinds of things. Textbooks are totally enrollment sensitive, so I'm just wondering why we're not seeing.
So do you really need textbooks?
Yes.
I didn't say you don't need textbooks.
No, I said, do you really? I'm joking.
So it's a line item, as you're right, there's been movement in this line item over the years. It used to be a standard line item, about $500,000. We moved it to about $300,000 several years ago, where it stayed for a while. Dipped a little bit last year. It comes down to, honestly, and it's in the materials we sent of the, and it's under the technology tab, I think, where we talk about the specific text we need. It comes down to certain courses that in the loop of the text that are coming up that we need to purchase due to condition, due to curricular changes, and that's the bump you see there from the current spending at 268 to 300.
You mentioned too in materials somewhere that the amount for some of the newer textbooks includes the online access that has a whole range of additional help material for students.
Some assessments, some enrichment stuff. Yeah.
I was curious about that too, only because it looked like we spent $183,000. I just didn't know. Are we expected to? I mean,
is that a year
between
end?
Now and the end, the end of the year? It seems like we would have already spent the money we're going to spend on textbooks for the year, and we're expecting to spend another $78,000 or something like that. So I was hoping that we might have seen some savings, but nothing that you feel comfortable that we can take off that $300,000.
Not there, no.
No.
I mean, we spoke specifically to that at one of the workshops and dug into the actual text and everything else. The board had similar questions. It's just not an area we would feel.
And it's replacing some books that are much, much too old.
Yeah.
And they're expensive.
Right. Oh, I believe you.
We all went
to college, so we remember those big, huge bills. then on page 16, advertising, that also has gone up and down a little bit, but your projected end-of-year expenditures this year is $114,000. Last year you spent $117,000, and you're asking for $135,000. So is there the potential for, I don't know exactly what you advertise or print or supplies, but
there's the $20,000 function is the bulk of the advertising by far, and there's definitely a volatility there, as we've seen in terms of you know, folks retiring and leaving and things of that nature. This is also a district-wide printing account area. So the publications that you see based on our student handbooks and scopes of booklets, those types of things also come out of there.
Those work those with an outside vendor, right? The printing of those.
Yes.
Okay.
And I'm just thinking of possible future savings idea for maybe because a town prints annual reports and maybe there's an opportunity to do some joint sourcing.
Some of the decrease here was because that copier contract that's part of that total estimated savings. Those copiers that are in this building get charged to this area, whereas the other ones get charged to the school. Mm-hmm. So that's part of that. And you know, we're certainly going to keep looking at these. Yeah, at these closely.
Okay. Travel and well, we talked a bit about professional development elsewhere, but professional development, recruitment, and travel and conferences were small areas. I mean, really small. But I wondered if there might be a little bit of wiggle room there to put things more tightly. And same with legal services, which is on page 14.
17.
That's
page 16.
16.
And then the legal services on page 14, which is also going up $10,000.
That, you know, we had talked a little bit about that. Yeah. That runs the cycle, that $10,000 increase, and when we moved into negotiations with the teachers' bargaining group and the administrators' bargaining group.
And that's coming up now.
And that's coming up now, and that's the services of shipment agreement to help us throughout that process. So. I mean, that contract's got a significant value, so I think to have really good legal counsel there is well worth it.
Maybe I could just suggest, Linda, that I think Matt's already asked, if we help give them a target of how much we're looking for and let them go through the small dollars, might be more productive use of all of our time. So just an idea.
Anyone else have questions on any of these line items? Okay. Sean, do you...
Linda, given the time now, because it's quarter of, I'm wondering, can I just... I have two really quick questions, and we want to work with them separately on this, but for your long-term capital, you have very substantially different state reimbursement rate assumptions for the junior high and your Latimer Lane projects. Can I just ask, is that intentional?
Is that the six-year CIP that you're talking about?
I believe so.
In their capital, five-year capital project, they have the two large projects are Latimer Lane and the junior high, and they have substantially different state reimbursement levels on them. One's 33% and one's closer to 20. And I just wanted to find out, is that intentional?
I was more conservative, Barbara, on the Henry James Phase 2 because maintenance work generally is not an eligible cost. And there are portions that will be eligible there, the fire suppression being a code compliance issue. So yes, there are some planned differences there to be a little more conservative.
So you have enough detail on your Henry James project to know what portion is not eligible for state funding already?
We have a general idea on the maintenance work that tends to be ineligible. They don't like to pay for maintenance work.
Right. So no, I understand that. I didn't know you had your project at that level of detail that you knew your expenses at this point.
It's really just a matter of, I think, estimating that a significant portion of it won't be eligible. So we're just trying to be realistic.
Anything else?
And the last question I just had was, you've increased your CNP, capital non-recurring. And so there's an increase in there for that too. We may take a look at, as we've done in the past, maybe paying cash for some of that, so that that may be another place that you won't need to put a budget increase in for. So we'll look at that, and hopefully we can, on the lines that we've asked you to look at again, you guys can take a second look, and then we can take a second look at what we can do to see if we can together find a little more here.
Barb, how would that function? Would it be the 1/5? Payback or
so but you'd save it for 5 years. So we pay cash instead of putting something in CNR potentially.
Yeah. Okay.
I just one quick question on the six-year, on that six-year plan, since Barb raised that, which is that I saw on the field replacement, I saw a note just saying, did not recommend alternate infills to crumb rubber, but additional resilient pad for shock absorption. I just thought, to the extent the viewing audience reviews your slides online, is that to address the health risks that have been raised recently regarding the rubber and the turf? Do we know has that?
The base bid for the project was what's called a coated crumb rubber, and the coating gives it a green color, so it keeps the heat down for those folks, you know, using the field in warm weather. Weather. We did have a bid opening recently, and we do have an alternate that includes not a recycled crumb rubber, but a man-made TPE or EPDM. So we're actually in the process of reviewing those
bids. And is some of that to address some of the health risks that have been raised recently on the?
It would be to address that concern that some have.
Thank you.
Sean, we've got 14 minutes left.
Right. No pressure.
Well, like I said, I don't have a formal presentation. What you have in front of you, though, is the mill rate worksheet. This is, I know, familiar to those of you that have been on the board before. It's maybe new otherwise. But this is the tool we use every year in the meeting in Henry James cafeteria at the end of the referendum. Assuming the budget is passed, and this board meets at 8:30 that night and sets the mill rate. We have tried to adapt it over the years to be more of a tool real-time as well, where we can plug in some assumptions. You'll notice the way this particular page is set up, you can assume a few different budget increases to these appropriations. So let me just start real quick with, these are the appropriations up on top. You see that we have the current, as you're probably aware, the Board of Selectmen currently stands at 3.75% budget increase. And the Board of Ed, as you saw tonight, 2.2. These numbers here are not exactly tying within the dollar because, again, these are the cells that are being adjusted, so they're within, you know, a few $100. But it for purposes of seeing where we are, this is, you know, kind of a handy tool. One of the tabs I have here, it was mentioned already, what are the revenues we're projecting? This is always a difficult one to see on the slide here. Actually, this is not as bad as it's been years past. But these are all the roll-ups. There's no secret that most of our revenue comes from comes from property taxes. But basically, this revenue roll-up feeds this indirect revenue cell right here, of in this case 9.3. So it can be, I'm not going to necessarily walk through all of these right here, but some of the major items, some that are new this year that you're probably familiar with, I'm sure Joe has talked about a little bit, the municipal car tax. We are, as a community with a mill rate higher than 32, going to be held to 32 on the car tax. That's great news for the residents who are also going to see, you know, obviously a tax decrease on their car property. But we are also being held harmless, so to speak, or made whole, depending on how you want to say, in terms of a grant. That's this item right here, $1 million, the current estimate from OPM. And so I'm not sure where you're going.
We're actually showing we're being made more than whole. There's an extra $100,000 there that we're planning on.
That is correct.
Sean, ECS is up, what, 300?
I believe that is right. Yep, there's the last year, 5.6 million, and you have 5.9 here.
Yeah. Can I just ask
so
a
again, all
question?
That comes into the general fund.
I think the line item we're all most concerned about is the
874.
Yes.
Yeah. Municipal revenue sharing.
Yep, right. So this is
where the state's giving us part of the sales tax.
That's correct. Right. There's an additional proposed $775,000 for our share of the percent increase of the sales tax. Every indication is that that is still the plan. I've not heard otherwise, but that is that definitely factored into our mill rate calculation, our revenues. Given that, I'm not sure exactly where, how you want to sort of play with this, but what you're seeing here is I have a setup at the moment with a mill rate, our current mill rate of 37.12, and what a flat mill rate would be at 37.12, this green cell here of 208,000 is how far we are away from that at the moment. Right? Between all the budgets.
Can I understand better the $100,000 difference between making us whole and
the surplus?
The surplus, because I would expect that that's probably, we can just kiss that goodbye probably, because the governor's going to be looking for every opportunity where it's not statutorily mandated.
Right. I don't have, yeah, the short answer is I don't have, I can get that for you for next week. And let me talk to Joe to confirm. Again, there is a lineup when you're looking at which tax year you're looking at, which cars were on the grand list this year. You know, so I want to say the difference is we had more cars added to our grand list than we anticipated. Their numbers, so we may, or vice versa, I suppose. But either way, I know it's a difference in timing of what cars are on the grand list at that time. And then they do their best estimate of how much revenue they're going to replace for us. But let me, I'll talk to Mr. Mancini and see.
It cannot reimburse us would require a legislative enactment, correct? At this point, on
I'm sorry,
to not reimburse us that million, whatever would
be a stash of
legislation.
Yeah,
okay.
Will you be able to email us out the sheet as in the past?
As in the past, yeah. It's not the same one I did 2 years ago when I did this, where you could play with some of the numbers a little yep. better. I'm still trying to get it to do that again.
Well, when you get it to do that again.
Well, yeah. I know.
2.0. And I just want to go back over, because I know I've talked with Matt about this too, that at least I know Barbara and I both have the same concern, probably everybody on this board does, that, you know, we're all reading the newspapers and seeing that they're in desperate straits at the state level. And while it's very hard, having been in those seats before myself, it's very hard to cut something that somebody's used to having, you know, whether it's services for your disabled child or ECS or, but that sharing of the sales tax revenue is something that nobody has had before. So it's right. very easy to eliminate something that nobody's yet gotten used to having. So I'm certainly hopeful that we'll only have a $200,000 gap, but if you change that one line item on that revenue sheet, it suddenly becomes $1 million gap. And so I think, you know, what's difficult for us is, you know, we have to do a budget prior to the state ever finishing its budgetary work. So this is a perennial problem, but I think a bit of a larger problem this year than usual, just because the state's in even worse shape than usual. And I really do think that that's a very real risk. On the flip side, I for one don't want to, you know, cut people here in the town needlessly if in fact that money does somehow miraculously materialize and then we've been overly strict on both the Board of Selectmen and the Board of Ed. So, I mean, I think what we're going to try to do is figure out, and I think we need to talk about this next week as a board, you know, do we budget towards the $200,000 gap, but make sure that all three boards have an agreement on a contingency plan that if the worst case scenario comes to pass, that we know in advance what's going to happen, because we'll know that, hopefully, before July 1st. And so we need an action plan of what do we each cut or change or, you know, whatever at that point. And so we need some legal advice and some strong brainstorming as a three-part team.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's worth noting, I mean, just for a little, you know, some perspective, I suppose, if you can change, you know, this is something that the old spreadsheet did a little differently, but if you set a goal seek sort of function in Excel to setting that difference to zero, you can actually see what your projected impact is on the mill rate. So if you change, you know, if we assume that green cell is zero by changing this cell, you end up with what the impact would be of that change, the worst case scenario, so to speak. And you're seeing a 1.29% tax increase, right? So a mill rate would go from 37.12 to 37.6. So in that sort of worst case scenario, only increase it 1.4%.
You can also goal seek, though, for the percentage, the weighted average percentage increase, and right.
So can I just add something? I want to clarify that we don't have the luxury of waiting, which Linda said, waiting to see what they're going to do. So we have to make a call as a board, because once it's appropriated and it's voted on at the town meeting, the board, both sides, the Board of Ed and the Board of Selectmen, have that money appropriated and they can spend it. So we can, quote, have an agreement that they're not going to spend what got appropriated, but they have the right to do that because they will have, it already will have passed at town meeting. So the question for us is to decide whether or not we want to hedge it, do something in the middle, whether we want to see if there's some more we can do now, because if it doesn't happen and they've already got the money appropriated because we went forward with their budgets the way they are right now, and assuming we can find the 200, that means we're planning to not raise taxes enough to cover expenditures when that happens. And so how that works mathematically is, it is your reserves just fall by whatever your shortage is. So if you overspend, and it would be the same thing as having your collection rate go down on your taxes. If you didn't collect as much as you assumed, then your reserves would your general reserve would start to fall. Mm-hmm. And so that's what we have to talk about as a group, is reserve levels, capital levels, and then multi-year needs. And I think that's going to be a good topic for our next meeting, but we have to figure out before we go to the town meeting, and really definitely before it goes in front of the voters, what does Board of Finance want to do? How do we want to approach this?
Hey, Barb, can you help me better understand, because I don't know the answer to this, and maybe people here, what the reserve levels are looking like right now?
They're looking okay right now. This is coming in as a strong year right now, assuming nothing happens between now and year end. So we're a little higher than what our range is that we need, but we have to talk about what we foresee, and so that's looking more in a longer term. Yeah. But as we know, even if we get to keep the car tax this year, there wasn't a commitment even made to make us up for the shortfall again next year, which is another million hole. And if the 775 didn't happen this year, it's not going to happen again next year, which means, you know, your percentage increase is starting off with that before anybody adds anything for negotiated contracts or anything else. So we kind of, and then you've got the Hartford property. We're projecting a timetable lapse between when we start to get the income back in from the new build versus now, and that's going to hit us. So we've got to look kind of at, we don't want to hit the taxpayers with a huge tax increase, and that's kind of why that reserve is there and how we play with that a little bit.
Yeah, I think that...
And
that,
we have the ability at any year to only appropriate an additional 1% of our budget, which is, you know, a little over 900,000, that we can appropriate with monies not appropriated at budget time.
Yeah.
And that's part of what we've already taken a piece of that, the 70 we approve. Every time we authorize something out of cycle, it comes out of that 1%. So we've already used some of it, and we've talked tonight about other areas we might be able to use it with. And anytime we talk about spending things where we could maybe fund it without paying for it in CNR, like the example I gave, anything we do like that where we're paying for something up front, it's got to come out of that 1%, or at budget time, we determine it's going to come out of our basically our reserve level.
Yeah,
so that's all the conversation that we'll have at the next meeting.
I just wanted to add to that, or reinforce that context, because that's just where I was going to go next. I had hoped that we would have had time at this meeting to talk a little bit about it, but we'll do that at the next meeting. You know, the Long Range Planning Committee has been trying to do some modeling about what happens with the Hartford. Sean and I are going to work on that model a bit again tomorrow. But, you know, there's a short-term dip in revenue that we have to plan for. So, you know, while we are in fact at 12.93% reserves and our guidelines are 10 to 12, we need to factor that in. And so, you know, I for one certainly don't want to be overtaxing people and keeping money under the mattress when there's a real need for it. But we also need to be cognizant of not only the Hartford coming up, but the reduction in the car tax ceiling without the making us whole bit from the state that will further impair us in the coming year.
My bit of caution would be, and I totally understand the thread of conversation with the uncertainty at the state, is we've kind of grabbed hold of this $700,000. There could potentially be other things. So the plan, I mean, we've made the decision, or you've made the decision based on information or whatever we have, that $700,000 could potentially go.
$775,000,
sorry. We haven't got hard word on that. It's hard for us to do the likely scenarios because there could be another one. There could be a 5% across the board. There could be something else. We've never planned that way. I understand that it's in disarray right now. We've had other years where it has been, and we've always planned and presented the budget to the public based on where we were and the goals that we've established. So, I mean, it's a balance of where we have to be in dollars that big. When they're, I don't want to speak for Lisa, but when they're put back on our budgets to think about, they're definitely positions, they're definitely people, they're definitely things that we just talked about putting in. So it becomes a different kind of conversation organizationally, that's all.
Well, I think, as I said, at least for me at this point, if we can aim at working through that $200,000 difference, and there were some ideas that came up today, the $25,000 for NEASC, $50,000 for professional development, $45,000 unemployment, and then something around CNR. I mean, those are all things
we
have to go back and look at, but
over the next couple of weeks.
Right. So, you know, we may be in good shape if the state comes through, but again, I think we need a little legal advice if maybe we can get Bobby D to weigh in about process, because I think Barbara raised a good issue. Once it's appropriated, is there any? It's appropriated, but we are all gentlemen and gentlewomen here, and we can shake hands and make agreements. I don't know what the options are, but you know, I think we need to have a contingency plan, particularly looking out over the horizon and seeing that the sun's not coming up anytime soon. So,
to say it's just very frustrating because there's also the new statute, which I think kicks in next year, where if we have to increase budgets over a certain amount, which we might have to do, right over 2.5%, to respond to cutbacks from the state government. Are we going to be penalized for that with additional cuts?
Although that's tied, Lisa can speak to that. That is tied to some other piece.
Are you talking about the 2.5%?
Yeah,
right.
So the 2.5%, the 775 is the revenue we will get from the sales tax.
Right.
The 2.5% cap, as I understand it, last Friday, and it does seem to change every few days, is that that applies to that 775. So if we go over the 2.5% cap on the budget, it's budget, they don't care about revenue, it's not the net,
right.
It's literally the budget, so it penalizes towns that are growing. But if you go above that 2.5%, what's at risk is half of the 775.
But if they take the 775 away, then the 2.5 cap goes
away. Yeah, and just to sort of put that 775 in perspective, say it goes away, that's a $6 a month difference in a tax bill for the average taxpayer. And if you eliminate the $200,000, you can lessen that. And if you change your mill rate assumption collection rate, you can lessen that too.
Right.
So while it is, you know, a concern, I want to put it in perspective. It's about just over a $6 difference per month for the average taxpayer. So this is not catastrophic. Is it something we want to pay attention to? Of course. But there are other things, you know, like just eliminating the $200,000 will go a long way. Not change the collection rate, maybe a quarter of a percent assumption. That goes a long way. So there are other things, you know, you can look at as you look at it. So in terms of perspective, it's just over a $6 difference, as I understand it. Is that about right, Sean?
I'm not going to be comfortable changing the collection rate until I know whether they're going to continue to do the DMV thing.
It's
all in the conversation.
Right, that's all part of the whole conversation.
Exactly.
But there are many things that impact the mill rate. It's not just...
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yep, absolutely. So, all right, I don't want to keep the next group waiting, but definitely plan that next week when we meet, bring your brown bag dinner because you're going to be here for a long time, and make sure we get us a room that we don't have to leave.
Our two regular meetings that night and the only two.
How about the library program room? I mean, I think I just don't want people to feel like they're being squeezed and not have the opportunity to.
I'd like to say before we get that.
Can I ask for a little quiet, please?
Yeah, I really did, as a first time going through this, appreciate the great level of detail and the thoughtful way this is all presented, and it was very, very helpful.
Great.
Really, really appreciate the hard work that went into that.
Yeah. Terrific.
For anybody at home viewing, they should look at the tab you put together, which I thought was excellent on the cost savings.
Yeah, we need to go through that next time, too. We didn't have a chance to, and I would like to.
The cooperative efforts tab was excellent. Thank you.
Oh, yes. Sorry. Thank you. When we last month appointed Sean as the interim finance director, we didn't also use the word treasurer, and he is, in fact, both. So I need a motion to appoint him as the treasurer as well.
So move.
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion to adjourn?
Yes.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
I'm sure it's reflected. I voted yes, too.
All right.
And interim treasurer, I think. Did you say interim in front of the word treasurer?